From among all the prophets, Muhammad was the last. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And welcome to this series where we are going to discuss a very important topic, a significant topic that most of us who are mixing with non-Muslims are in need of. This topic is how to defend Islam, or let us call it the art of defending Islam. The art of defending Islam. Now, let me clarify the aim behind this topic. We are not aiming to talk about the art of debate. The art of debate is a very long subject and we won't be able to cover it. But we are talking about a specific part of the art of debate, which is the art of defending Islam. So those who are engaged in dialogues, in debates against other religions or with other religions, they need this topic, which is how to defend Islam. Not only that, but normal Muslims who are living with non-Muslims, and most of us are living with non-Muslims, are always challenged by questions from non-Muslims, questions about Islam, or sometimes allegations against Islam. We need to have certain tools to help us to give appropriate answers for those who are either forwarding questions against Islam or for those who are accusing Islam of certain things. So, we'll come to this series where we are discussing the art of debate. We will mention certain principles, and those principles, once we gathered them together, then we will be able to formulate a theory behind the art of debate. First of all, let us talk about the first principle. The first principle is, and that principle is needed by everyone. This principle says that don't be engaged in any debate or any dialogue where you need to defend Islam and you yourself as a Muslim are not confident of your Islam, of your Iman. This is the first important rule. Don't think that if you are weak in terms of your Iman, you will be able to defend Islam. Even if you think that you will be able to defend Islam, yet you are weak in your Iman, you might accept the doubts that the people are forwarding to you. I remember a brother who was convert, and he told me that he was having debates with non-Muslims, and then himself, after some time, started to accept some of those doubts. I said to him, if you don't have enough knowledge, and if you don't have enough Iman that Islam is the ultimate truth, then don't be engaged in such debates. We know, all of us, I'm sure, that many of us know some, maybe, preachers, some shuyukh, some du'at, who are famous in debating non-Muslims about issues related to Islam, yet themselves started to act upon some of those debates and started to accept some of those doubts. And this is very dangerous. Some of them, those who started these debates, they accepted some of those doubts. And after some time, they started to develop their own version of al-Islam. And that is wrong. And the ultimate aim, brothers and sisters, is to defend al-Islam as it was revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as it was revealed by Allah Jalla wa Ala. not the Islam that I have developed, or the Islam that you have developed, or the Islam that anyone else has developed. We have to be careful. Allah Jalla wa Ala revealed Al-Quran, revealed the Sunnah, and also Allah Jalla wa Ala taught us certain principles to understand the Quran and Sunnah. Some of those principles the whole Ummah agreed upon, and hence there are certain aspects of Al-Islam that the whole Ummah agreed upon. We cannot change those aspects. We cannot develop a new version of Al-Islam. Whatever the Ummah from the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until our time or until recently, whatever the Ummah agreed upon, then that is Al-Islam. If the Ummah disagreed about something, and normally they disagree about things related to fiqh, how to pray, how to fast, how to give our zakah, how to deal with some financial transactions, how to conduct certain marriage ceremonies, etc. Those things where the scholars differ about, those things are a matter of ijtihad. And we accept and we tolerate different opinions. But the things that the whole Ummah agreed upon, we cannot change them. If we are unable to respond to non-Muslims, we should not change those principles that have been agreed by the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Otherwise, we will end up by changing Islam as many other religions, Christianity, Judaism, have changed their religions and they developed new versions of their religions. And that's why the Christianity that we have today is not the original religion that Allah Jalla wa Ala sent to Isa alayhi salam. The Judaism now is a distorted version of Judaism. It is not the
religion
that has been revealed to Musa alayhi salam. In fact, both Christianity and Judaism, as we all know, are actually al-Islam in its original form. إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. The deen that belongs to Allah Jalla wa Ala, the deen that Allah Jalla wa Ala has revealed to mankind, whether through Ibrahim alayhi salam, whether through Isa alayhi salam, whether through Musa alayhi salam, is nothing but to submit to the will of Allah Jalla wa Ala. One version of this deen was revealed to Isa alayhi salam, and historically it was known as Christianity. Now we have another form of Christianity and a distorted form of Christianity. Similarly, the deen that has been revealed to Musa alayhi salam is to submit to the will of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Historically, it was known as Judaism. The original form of Judaism is actually al-Islam, but the distorted version of Judaism is the one that we as Muslims disagree with. So, if we are not confident that al-Islam is the ultimate truth that Allah Jalla wa Ala has revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, we should not be engaged in such dialogues, because we might end up with a situation that we develop our own version of al-Islam, and that is very dangerous. This is one thing. The other thing, once we say that we need to have full confidence that al-Islam is the truth, al-Islam, in fact, is the ultimate and the only truth. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, we have mentioned the verse where Allah Jalla wa Ala says, إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ, that the deen that is acceptable by Allah Jalla wa Ala is to submit to the will of Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is one thing. The other thing is, al-Islam, which is the final message that has been revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has been sent to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through two main sources. The first source is Al-Quran, and the second source is the Sunnah, what Allah Jalla wa Ala inspired Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say, or to act upon, or to approve. This is the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the two main sources of Al-Islam. And then Allah Jalla wa Ala told us that He will inspire the whole ummah to agree on something, and once the whole ummah agreed upon something, then that is al-Islam. So the consensus of the ummah, which is al-Ijma', is the third source of al-Islam. These sources, as we said, form the ultimate truth. In the Quran, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ يَهْدِي لِلَّتِي هِيَ أَقْوَمُ وَيُبَشِّرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ الصَّالِحَاتِ أَنَّ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا كَبِيرًا in Surah Al-Isra. Indeed, this book guides to that what is better. That what is better in all our matters. That what is better for all of us. For the whole mankind. That's why in Surah Al-Baqarah, when Allah Jalla wa Ala spoke about the verses of As-Siyam, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنُ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ. The month of Ramadan in which the Quran was revealed. Revealed as what? As a guidance for mankind. And not only as a guidance for mankind, but a criteria to judge between what is right, what is wrong. Hence, whatever is in the Quran is right. And it is not only right, but it is the only right. Whatever the Quran does not approve, we consider it as Muslims. And actually, it is not right. The Quran is the criteria. We have to believe in that. There are many verses in the Quran where Allah Jalla wa Ala says that this book is actually guidance for mankind. And there are some ayat in which Allah Jalla wa Ala says that the Quran is hudan lil muttaqin. Alif lam mim, dhalika al-kitabu la rayba fihi hudan lil muttaqin. This book, there is no doubt in it. It is guidance for those who fear Allah Jalla wa Ala. So there are two types of verses. Verses that talk about the Quran as a guidance for the whole mankind, and verses that talk about the Quran as guidance for those who fear Allah Jalla wa Ala. So we have to believe, before being engaged in any debate or any discussion where we need to defend al-Islam, that Al-Quran is the ultimate and the only truth. Let us break now, and inshallah we will continue the discussion after the break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
From among all the prophets, Muhammad was the last.
In our search for true peace and the secret of life found only in Islam, it is important for us to highlight the permissible over the prohibited. So if you busy yourself with the do's, you don't have time to do the don'ts. So with this positive attitude, it makes it easier for you to call people to the truth found only in Islam. So join me, Arif Islam, as we go through the series, True Peace, The Secret of Life, only on Peace TV.
Proceed with the guidelines that lead towards everlasting happiness in True Peace, The Secret of Life. Every Friday at 11 p.m. and repeat telecast at 12 p.m. UK on Peace TV.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth? And who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch Truth Prevail and Lies Perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik. next on Peace TV.
From among all the prophets, Muhammad was the last.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. We were saying that before being engaged in any discussion or any debate where you need to defend al-Islam, you need to be confident that al-Islam is the ultimate truth. Al-Islam is the only truth. In the Quran, we read, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, or we read the statement where Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. The one who turns away from my remembrance or from my guidance, مَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي, from my guidance, he will have a ma'isha, a life full of misery. Means a life, in this life, in this dunya, he will not be punished in the hereafter only, but he will not live a happy life, this life, before death. And وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى, we will resurrect him, or her, of course, at the day of resurrection, أَعْمَى, as a blind person. قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى, they will say, why did you raise us or resurrected us as blind people? Allah Jalla wa Ala will respond to them, كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتِي فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. You have turned away from my guidance and you been ignorant towards my guidance, and we will turn away from you now. Which means that the one who is not benefiting from Al-Quran, the one who is not benefiting from Islam, he is going astray. Not only that, but he will not have a life full of contentment, full of happiness, full of tranquility, or sometimes we call it full of peace. And therefore, we, before being engaged in any discussion, we have to make sure that we have this principle clear, that anyone who turns away from the guidance of Allah Jalla wa Ala, he went astray. And he will not live a happy life or a life full of tranquility. If we don't have that confidence, I advise you, brothers and sisters, not to be engaged in such a discussion, because ultimately you might accept some of those doubts that some non-Muslims are forwarding. You might be confused yourself, or as we said in the beginning, you might develop your own version of al-Islam. So that is the first rule. I hope that this first rule is clear for every one of us. The second important rule that we need to clarify once we talk about defending al-Islam, and I hope all the brothers and sisters take note of these rules. The second rule is, once we talk about defending al-Islam, is it true or is it right to defend al-Islam? Someone will ask, what do you mean by that? Is it right to defend al-Islam? Of course, we have to defend al-Islam. No, that is not the question. The question is, yes, we need to clarify certain misconceptions about al-Islam, but we don't need to defend al-Islam, which means that we will be sitting in a defensive mode against someone who is offensive. Brothers and sisters, please read Al-Quran. And once you read Al-Quran, all of Al-Quran, and think particularly about the verses where Allah Jalla wa Ala is giving answers about Al-Islam. Does Al-Quran accept to be in a defensive position? Did Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever accepted to be in a defensive position? No, that is not the case. Why? Think about it from a psychological point of view. The person who is accepting to be in a defensive position, he had put himself, he had lowered himself And he has given the upper hand to his opponent, which means that he is mentally defeated. And the one who is mentally defeated, he will not be victorious whatsoever. And that's why if we as Muslims want to be victorious, first of all, we have to have the self-confidence and we have to be victorious in terms of our belief. Had we been in a defensive position, means that we are accepting the fact that the other people are setting the criteria and we are trying to compare ourselves to their criteria. And that is very dangerous. That's why I claim that the Quran never put itself in a defensive position. Al-Quran was answering some questions given by non-Muslims. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. They ask you about the ruh, the soul. And then the answer was given. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَنْفَالِ. They ask you about الْأَنْفَالِ, the war booty. Sometimes questions by Muslim. يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيضِ قُلْ هُوَ أَذَى. Now someone might say, what about Surah قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد? قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَد, this surah was revealed when a group of Jews asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to describe Allah jalla wa ala to them, to provide the lineage of Allah jalla wa ala, insib lana rabbak. And then Allah jalla wa ala revealed this surah. Look at this surah. Does it accept the allegation of those who accused or those who are giving this question? They never. This surah is not putting itself in a defensive position. It is just giving an answer. And in this surah, Allah Jalla wa Ala is giving the attributes of himself Jalla wa Ala, is describing himself Jalla wa Ala. That's all. If you put yourself in a defensive position, it has a psychological effect. As we said, you are putting yourself on the lower side and you are giving your opponent the higher side. Not only that, but psychologically as well, you are accepting part of what your opponent is saying. And that is very dangerous. Now, between Al-Islam and non-Al-Islam, it is true that there are some commonalities, some common things, but they are very minimum. The differences between Al-Islam and any other religion, any other distorted religion, as I said in the beginning of this episode, are huge. The differences are huge. The differences between Al-Islam and secularism are immense, huge. You cannot even compare Al-Islam with any other religion. You cannot even compare Al-Islam with secularism. Why? Because Al-Islam is the pure religion that Allah, the Creator, has revealed. Any other religion, Christianity, as we said, it is a distorted form of Christianity. And that's why there is a huge difference between the distorted version of Christianity and Al-Islam. There is a huge difference between the distorted version of Judaism and Al-Islam. And of course, there is a huge difference between secularism and Al-Islam. So you cannot compare between Al-Islam and any other system because any other system is considered to be a man-made system, including Christianity. Why? Because as we said, it is the distorted version of Christianity. We have no problem with the original form of Christianity, which is pure Tawheed, which is Al-Islam. And hence, once we are trying to defend Al-Islam, we have to put that in mind. And we have to put this fact in front of our eyes that there are huge differences between Al-Islam and any other system. Islam is the pure message that Allah Jalla wa Ala sent to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And based on this, we should start our debate with others. As I said, once you put yourself in a defensive mode, then you are accepting that there are common grounds between Al-Islam and other systems. And those common grounds, or this common ground, we have to be careful about defining it. Is it a small ground or is it a big ground? And as I said, it is a very small, limited piece of ground that might not enable us to say that we share certain fundamental values between Islam and any other system. So, until we see you, inshallah, in the coming episode, wait for the coming episode where we are continuing the discussion about the art to defend al-Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Muhammad, peace be upon his soul, the greatest of prophets.